This is Tanzania's National Museum, and it's a place that aims to promote and preserve the country's culture. Language is one of the most effective tools to preserve a culture, and here in Tanzania, Swahili is widely spoken, as it is in other parts of East, Central, and Southern Africa. In fact, it's the only African language officially recognized by the African Union. And starting this year, Swahili will be taught in schools in South Africa. Tulanana Bohela tells us more.
The majority of these people could be conversing in Kiswahili. Up to 90% of Tanzania's population speak the language. It is what unites this nation of 130 ethnic groups. Kiswahili is a language of administration. It is also widely used in schools and business. A few years ago, Tanzania became the first country in sub-Saharan Africa to have an African language as the sole language of instruction in its schools. The growing popularity of the language in the past two decades has largely been catapulted by music, breaking down cultural barriers in and across the region. But in a globalized world, can Tanzania be economically competitive with Swahili as the main language from a business point of view? And what are the advantages?
So in a globalized world, do you think that Tanzania can be economically competitive, especially from a business point of view?
I really think we can, but there's also a question of if we want to be really economically competent. I think we can, but there's a lot of limitation as of now. This is something that we can aspire to be in the future, because I truly believe when we talk about economically competent, then you have to look at your market share. So right now, if you want to really focus on Tanzanian market, then Swahili being a common language or being the main language, then that will give you the competent edge, because there's a lot of people in terms of population you can reach to. But in the current space that we currently have, where most of the companies are multinational companies, they operate in a global scale, and the means of communication is English. So I really think in a scale where we have to compete in that level, then Swahili is quite limited, depending on the interaction that we have either with customers, the direction that we have with other business we have to work with. Then we found ourselves that we have to use English so that we can be able to access more market share to other countries, and also more market share both internally because of the nature of company that we currently have.
While it's good that people are speaking Kiswahili here, is there a lack of capacity in English speaking for the labor force?
First of all, it really depends on the nature of job. So for some, I really understand some technical jobs, you really don't talk much. You have just to do. So the likes of constructors, engineers, the technical language is more or less the same. They can really work regardless of where you are. Now looking at the other sector, which is providing a service, if you use Swahili only, you find yourself stuck. The private sector is dominant with multinational companies, which they converse in English. So having a candidate or having someone who is both competent in both language gives you the room to be able to tap in the opportunities both in local companies and international companies. So having both language is something that is ideal, and I really think it's something that we should be able to push as an agenda, starting early at the educational level, building it up to workspace.
Notable universities in Africa and Europe and the United States are teaching the language, and South Africa is introducing the language in its schools this year. I'm here at the University of Dar es Salaam to meet Dr. Mosha, the director of the National Institute of Kiswahili.
How can the language be exploited to help in the economic development of Tanzania in the long term?
There is nothing more important in business like language. You and I, I'm sure, have traveled to different countries. When you are able to speak the language of the person that is selling the item to you, even the possibility of asking more questions on the product is made easy. So if you don't have a common language, it's difficult to do business. But that is one side of it. When you ask how there is business in language, first, there is publication of books, a big business. And we see this in many other languages. If you are not able to open companies that will produce the needed product, you will get stuck. I call the language a product because we need to publish more books and also prepare more Kiswahili teachers. So it is a product that sells through books, teachers, translators, and interpreters. Those are the sectors that will benefit in one way or another. So these are the ways to see the Kiswahili language as a product in the market.
Some have called for the adoption of Kiswahili as Africa's common language, one that could unite the continent. It remains to be seen how many countries in Africa will actually incorporate it into their school curriculum in the next few years.
That report was from Tulanana Bohela.